Yes, you can proceed.
Good evening. A warm welcome to all of you to the webinar series hosted by Advocates Association Bengaluru. We have with us today Honorable Mr. Justice H.P. Sandesh, Judge, High Court of Karnataka. My lords, we are both privileged and honored to have your lordships with us today. Welcome to the webinar.
Thank you.
With immense pleasure, now I would like to introduce our today's speaker, His Lordship, Honorable Mr. Justice Hethur Puttaswamy Gowda Sandesh. His Lordship is an alumni of M. Krishna Law College at Hasana District, from where His Lordship completed his five-year law course. His Lordship enrolled as an advocate in the year 1992 and was nurtured under the aegis of Sri K. Anantaramaya, a noted advocate in Hasan District. His Lordship later moved to Bangalore in 1994 and worked with JP Associates. His Lordship started his independent practice in the year 2001. Later in 2002, His Lordship joined the Karnataka State Judiciary. His Lordship has served as the additional district and sessions judge in the districts of Mandya and Mangaluru, and as the principal district and sessions judge in Mysuru and Haveri districts. His Lordship has also served as the Chief Secretary to the Honorable Chief Justice, later served as the Registrar Administration, Registrar Infrastructure, Registrar Vigilance of the Honorable High Court of Karnataka. Later, His Lordship was elevated as the Judge of the Honorable High Court of Karnataka. My Lords, on behalf of Advocates Association Bengaluru, I extend a warm welcome to your Lordships. Over to you, your Lordships.
Thank you. Good evening for everyone. First, I would like to make it clear, whatever the knowledge I am having with regard to the digital evidence, I would like to share with all of you. And law is not evolved more in this aspect, though the special enactments were brought in 2000, almost we have completed two decades after the bringing enactment in Information Technology Act 2000. The judiciary is also to imbibe technology in view of the advancement of technology and science. That's the reason. Now, first I would like to thank the Bangalore Advocates Association giving me an opportunity to share my knowledge, whatever little knowledge I am having with regard to the digital evidence. Before coming to the subject assigned to me, to enlighten the bar members and other friends, first, I would like to give some important aspects regarding the admissibility of digital evidence. Going to the subject, first, I will make it clear, the enactment was brought in the Indian Evidence Act in 1872 that came into force on 1/9/1872. The judicial system was introduced by the British when the India was colony of the British administration. First, the committee was set up to enact the Indian Evidence Act. The commissioners were appointed and committee has given the report. Thereafter, the Indian Evidence Act was brought into. We are having almost 150-year-old enactment, Indian Evidence Act. In view of development of technology and advancement of science, the challenge was made to our country to consider the digital evidence. In view of this development of advancement and technology, in order to provide speedy justice, to focus on accuracy and also the main important of providing justice to the people who approaches the court with a fond hope that they would get the justice from the court. The new enactments were also brought into in the year 2000, the Information Technology Act, and certain amendments are also made to the Bankers Books Evidence Act and also RBI Act, and particularly the Evidence Act, certain provisions are amended in view of the challenges to consider the digital evidence. The main provisions are amended with regard to the Evidence Act is concerned. Section 3, evidence, the word is also, by making an amendment, word is also included, electronic record. Apart from that, Section 17 is also amended with regard to the admission. And again, with regard to Section 22A is also introduced with regard to oral admission containing in the electronic records. The other provisions are also amended. Section 34, Section 35, Section 39, Section 45A, 47A, 59, and also Section 65A and B. The other provisions amended are also Section 67A with regard to proof as to e-signature, and other provisions, Section 73A also. Then with regard to the presumptions, Section 81, 85, 85B, 85C, 88A, 90A. These are the amendments were made to the Indian Evidence Act 1872. I also would like to refer the important provisions of in the IT Act relating to e-evidence. Those sections are Section 2 defines various terms with regard to the technical terms like data, digital signature, electronic record, computer, computer network. All provisions are, all sections are defined with regard to the IT Act is concerned. The other sections are Section 4, 5, 6, 7, and Section 79A of Central Government to notify examiner of e-evidence. Now, coming to the aspect of the digital evidence is concerned, it is the duty of the court to ensure that the people who approaches the court with a fond hope that they get the justice from this institution, court has to look into, examine, and its authenticity of the material which has been placed before the court. Now, with regard to Section 3 of Evidence Act is concerned, I have already pointed out the word document and evidence amended, inclusion of electronic record. The other provision, Section 19 also, 22A, and which I have not referred earlier. Now, coming to the aspect of digital evidence is concerned, first we should know what is digital evidence. The digital evidence or electronic means probative information stored or transmitted in digital form. Once again, I will repeat, what is digital evidence or electronic evidence? That is an information, probative information stored and transmitted in digital form. Now, coming to the aspect of how the law is evolved with regard to the digital evidence. Prior to 2000, before bringing the Information Technology Act, now we have adopted the video conference. Now, due to the impact of COVID-19, now it is become video conference become order of the day. First, it was recognized by the apex court in the judgment of Praful Desai's case in 2003. Page AIR Supreme Court, page 2053. The video conference was recognized in the year 2003, immediately after the enactment was brought into IT Act in 2000. The one more case reported judgment of the apex court is with regard to Amitabh Bakshi. In the said case also, the Supreme Court, with regard to the accepting the video conference, reiterated the earlier judgment of Praful Desai's case. In 2003 and 2005, the video conference is recognized and accepted by the apex court. Then how the law is evolved is concerned. We all know one of the judgment, leading judgment of Parliament attack case, popularly known as Parliament attack case, Navjot Sandhu versus NCT, Delhi versus Navjot Sandhu case, that is Afzal Guru's case. The section 65B has been discussed in detail in this judgment. When the accused was convicted, appeal was taken before the apex court. In the apex court, the accused counsel has raised the issue with regard to section 65B. The main and contention of the counsel is that section 65B is not complied. That is the ground he has urged before the apex court. The apex court in this judgment, which is reported in 2005, held that if a person is having acquainted with the information which has been placed before the court, comes and deposes before the court, that is enough. Even in the absence of non-compliance of section 65B, the same can be considered. This judgment of 2005, again, the question before the apex court in 2014 in Anwar and Bashir case. In Anwar and Bashir case, Supreme Court, when the question raised before the court, after hearing the arguments, overruled the judgment of the apex court with regard to the Parliament attack case, coming to the conclusion that law laid down in the Parliament attack case, Afzal Guru's case, that is non-compliance of section 65B is erroneous, and comes to the conclusion that it requires strict compliance of section 65B. When this judgment was pronounced, later some of the questions again raised before the Supreme Court. Popularly known as Sonu case, the judgment in P.V. Bashir's case delivered by three judges. In Sonu case, two judges have delivered the judgment, discussed in detail with regard to section 65B, and discussed and held that the judgment of P.V. Bashir's case, it comes to an effect, it is a retrospective effect. Certain difficulties in accepting the judgment of P.V. Bashir's case, if the judgment is accepted as retrospective effect, it will lead to complication to reopening of the cases which have already been considered and in detail discussed the judgment and held, and also comes to the conclusion that in order to maintain the propriety of judgment of larger bench, they did not take a decision whether it is a retrospective effect or prospective effect, they left it to the again to the larger bench to consider the effect of applicability of the judgment rendered in P.V. Bussey's case. Then other judgments with regard to the applicability of P.V. Bussey's case, one more judgment is delivered, that is Vikram Singh was a State of Punjab. In that case also, the question again arised whether Section 65B and Section 62 of Evidence Act with regard to the admissibility of electronic records. The question come up before the Supreme Court with regard to the production of original tape recorded conversation with regard to the ransom call handed over to the police. The apex court in this judgment held that it is a primary evidence and therefore certificate under Section 65B is not required. Such certificate is necessary only for secondary evidence. That is the judgment of the apex court. No doubt Section 65B, compliance of Section 65B is with regard to when the secondary evidence is placed before the court has to consider the 65B compliance. In one more judgment of the Supreme Court, subsequent to the judgment of Bashir case, that is Harpal Singh alias Chota versus State of Punjab reported in 2017. Here also again, with regard to the admissibility of what are the requirements to consider the digital evidence. In this judgment also, the apex court held Section 65B Evidence Act and Electronic Evidence requirements for admissibility, two aspects. One is with regard to the electronic evidence in the nature of secondary evidence cannot be admitted unless requirements of Section 65B are satisfied. In this judgment also, they reiterated the principles laid down in the judgment of P. Bashir's case. The other aspect in this judgment is, in the said case, CDRs are produced. The apex court says CDRs are produced to prove conspiracy to kidnap for ransom, but fail to adduce certificate as required under Section 65B4. However, the apex court says those CDRs were held inadmissible. However, the conviction was upheld on the basis of other evidence. No doubt, when the court appreciates the material and record under Section 136 of the Evidence Act, the court has to consider both digital evidence and other evidence also. Even in the absence of the digital evidence, if other evidence available before the court is sufficient, then the conviction is sustained. Now again, one more judgment was delivered, that is contradictory to the earlier judgment of P.V. Bussey's case, that is Shafi Muhammad case. In Shafi Muhammad case also, when the question is moved before the apex court with regard to the compliance of Section 65B, in the Shafi Muhammad case, the apex court, that is also two bench judgment, comes to a conclusion that compliance of Section 65B is a procedural. In the earlier case, P.V. Bussey's case, the Supreme Court held that it is mandatory. The observation of the apex court in this Shafi Muhammad case, that when the material is placed before the court, if the device is not in possession of the person who place the same before the court, then an exception can be given. That is the principle laid down in the judgment Safi Ahmad case, which is contradictory to the judgment of P.V. Bashir's case and Harpal Singh case. Then again, question arises before the court. Now, in the recent judgment of the apex court, since the matter was referred to the larger bench in Arjun Pandit Rao Kotkar case, the elected MLA case was questioned before the court. Two benches judges of the Supreme Court have referred this matter to the full bench. Question is with regard to filing of nomination within the time, whether the nomination is filed within the time, that has been questioned before the court. When the matter come up before the division bench of the Supreme Court comes to a conclusion that the earlier there was a judgment of three bench judgment, the matter requires to be referred to the full bench. In this judgment, which is reported in 2020, SEC online SC 571. Here we have to examine earlier Safi Mohammed case. Justice Nariman is also the part of the earlier judgment. In this judgment also, the Justice Nariman has delivered the judgment. And the other judge, Justice R. Ravindra Bhat, accepted the judgment. And the other judge, Rama Subramanian, in addition to the judgment rendered by the Justice Nariman, made some observation in the judgment with regard to and accepted the judgment, however, made an observation that the enactment was brought into 20 years back. Section 65B has to be re-looked into. That is the judgment. However, accepted the judgment, earlier judgment of Justice P.V. Bashir's case. That is, now law is settled in view of subsequent three division bench judgment, which is rendered in 2020. The earlier judgment of P.V. Bashir case held that the principles laid down in the judgment, earlier judgment, is correct law, and law laid down in the P.V. Bashir's case is correct, and the principle laid down in the judgment, subsequent judgment of Safi Mohammed case, is not correct. That judgment is overruled with regard to the observation of Safi Mohammed case that the person who is not having the device in his possession, if he is unable to place the certificate under Section 65(4), is not correct. And the apex court held that it is mandatory and not procedural. If Section 65(b)(4) is not complied, then digital evidence which has been placed before the court cannot be accepted. Now, in view of the recent judgment of the apex court in Arjun Pandit Rao Kotkar case, after referring the matter to the larger bench, now it is settled law that compulsory it requires certificate under Section 65. In order to prove the secondary evidence, certificate is mandatory. Earlier in the Sonu case, some aspect has diluted with regard to the production of certificate. In Sonu case, apex court discussed, subsequent to the judgment of Anwar case, in the judgment held that CDRs were marked before the trial court. The objections, if any, relating to mode or method of proof has to be raised at the time of marking the document as an exhibit before the trial court, but not at a later stage. Referring the earlier judgments of the apex court while delivering the judgment in Sonu's case, if any objections is raised, that has to be decided at that time only. Further observed that if the document is marked without any objection, and if the document is marked subject to objection, then prosecution would have cured the objection raised at the stage of trial itself. Now it cannot be looked into. It cannot be raised at the time of appellate stage. That was the principle laid down in Sonu's case, examining with regard to the admissibility of document. It is held that the crucial test is whether defect could have been cured at the stage of marking the document. If an objection was taken to mark CDS without certificate, the court could have given an opportunity to the prosecution to ratify the mistake. Objections regarding admissibility of documents which are per se inadmissible can be taken if at an appellate stage. That was the question also raised before the apex court in Sonu's case. Now, one more judgment I would like to refer, the judgment arises from Karnataka only in Hiremath's case, which was delivered in 2019 Supreme Court in the month of May, 2019 May. The question again crop up before the Supreme Court. While filing the charge sheet itself, whether it should contain the certificate under Section 65B. The appeals court in this judgment, Hiremath's case, says that that was delivered in May 2019. The apex court says, having regard to the above principle of law, the High Court erred in coming to the conclusion that the failure to produce a certificate under Section 65B4 of the Evidence Act at the stage when the charge sheet was filed was fatal to the prosecution. The need of production of such a certificate would arise when the electronic evidence is sought to be produced in evidence at the trial. It is that stage that the necessity of the production of the certificate would arise. Now, it is made it clear that when the charge sheet is filed, if the charge sheet doesn't contain the Section 65B certificate, that is not fatal to the case of the prosecution. The same can be produced at the time of marking the document. In Sonu case also, the apex court held it can be cured if any objection is raised at the time of marking of the digital evidence. The main object of bringing enactment to Section 65B is concerned when the secondary evidence is placed before the court. Court has to see whether they have complied the provisions, whether the document placed before the court to identify the device under which the document was brought into, and also it requires the certification from the concerned official who is having the power to certify the same, certifying authority whether he has certified it or not. And only after the court examining the material placed before the court under Section 136 of Evidence Act, it is the duty of the judge to consider whether the material placed before the court, digital evidence placed before the court, is admissible or inadmissible, and then take a decision to admit the document. When such being the case, and when the digital evidence is placed before the court, it is the duty cast upon the court to see that whether it is admissible under Section 136. Again, the powers are also given to the court under Section 165. The court can put any questions, if any doubt, with regard to the either the document or oral evidence or documentary evidence if it is required to find out the truth. The very purpose of conducting the trial is also, you all know, to find out the truth and provide justice to the people who approaches the court. That is justice delivery system. While considering the material and record also, the court, it is the duty cast upon the court and bounden duty to see that the document which is placed before the court is admissible or not. The very purpose, the speedy trial, to focus on quality and also the authenticity of the document, and also to see that justice should be done. The court should not be a mute spectator. At the time of recording the evidence, court must be vigilant and consider the objections raised at the time of marking the document, whether it is complied with the provisions of section 65B. Now, with regard to the provisions of section 45A and 47A, in respect of the digital signature also, the court can take the assistance of the expert's opinion under section 45A and also section 47A in respect of authenticity of the document of e-signature. The other presumptions are also brought into with regard to section 81, 85, 88 under section 90. These are the presumptions also court can take into note of the documents which have been placed before the court. Particularly, documents with regard to, for example, e-gazette, ...65 to 81A to 85A, 88A and 90A. If these provisions are taken note of with regard to the presumptions in respect of digital evidence, the court can verify and examine authenticity of documents. Now, the question before the court, what are all the digital evidence? The digital evidence, which I have already mentioned, the definition, which is defined as any information of probative value that is either stored or transmitted in a digital form. But nowhere in the Evidence Act or in the Information Technology Act, the word digital evidence is not defined. But other aspects of what are the device in which the digital information is stored is also defined in IT Act, IT Act 2000. Digital evidence can be found from emails, digital photographs, bank ATM transaction logs, instant message histories, spreadsheets, internet browser histories, databases, the contents of computer memory, computer backups, computer printouts, global positioning system tracks, server logs, audio and video recording and files, locks from a hotel electronic door locks, etc. That is anything that can be stored on electronic devices. If electronic devices are placed and found, materials are stored, and computer input are also used, and statements are recorded, then certificate under section 65B is necessary in order to prove the secondary evidence. The other question also considered in P.V. Bashir's case, the Supreme Court says section 63 and 65 of the Evidence Act cannot be looked into while considering the digital evidence. Specifically, comply section 65B and not section 63 and 65. Proving the digital evidence. That was the principle laid down in the judgment in Basir's case. The specific provisions which has been amended with regard to section 65B, that has to be complied. Then only the general law is not applicable. The special amendment made to the Indian Evidence Act has to be complied. But in the subsequent judgment, the same was diluted. Now, in view of the judgment of the Apex Court in 2020 in Arjun Kotkar's case, it is mandatory to produce the certificate before the court with regard to the authenticity of the document which has been placed before the court. These are the judgments are subsequent to the bringing the amendment and also the bringing new act, IT Act in 2000. Prior to that, before the Supreme Court also certain questions are raised with regard to the telephonic conversations. In the judgment 1964 on Pratap Singh versus State of Punjab, the Punjab High Court declined to accept the telephonic conversation held between the parties, coming to the conclusion that the same is inadmissible for the reason that the said record is susceptible to tampering. That is the reason, that was the reason given by the Punjab High Court in 1964 when the matter came up before the Supreme Court in a judgment reported in Pratap Singh versus State of Punjab 1964 page 72. The Apex Court says there were three tape recorded talks relevant to the incident. The Honorable High Court of Punjab, without saying in so many words, held that this tape recorded evidence is inadmissible in evidence for the reason that tape recordings were capable of being tampered with. That was the reason given by the Punjab High Court. Then Supreme Court says, when the matter came up before the Supreme Court, held that the said stand cannot be agreed with simply because there are few documents and possibility of no piece of evidence which could not be tampered with, but that would certainly not be a ground on which the courts could reject the evidence as inadmissible or refuse to consider. The Honorable Supreme Court, under the facts and circumstances of the case, held that the records are genuine and the conversation took place as recorded. It again, I am pressing into section 136. It is the duty of the judge at the time of admitting the document to examine whether the same is admissible or not. Again, a similar question arises before the Supreme Court in the year 1973. R.M. Malkani versus State of Maharashtra, one Supreme Court cases 471. Here also regarding tape recorded conversation, Evidence Act. Admissibility of tape recorded conversation, held tape recorded conversation admissible, provided here three rider was put on the court while accepting the evidence with regard to the tape recording conversation. Three riders were put. One is with regard to conversation is relevant to the matter in issue. Two, there is identification of the voice. Three, the accuracy of the tape recorded conversation is proved by eliminating the possibility of erasing the tape record. And further held that there is no dispute about the identification of a voice and no controversy of any portion of the conversation being erased or mutilated. Therefore, it is held that tape recorded conversation is admissible in evidence. In this judgment also discussed with regard to the Article 23, incriminating evidence against the accused, whether the tape recorded conversation infringes the articles 20 and 21. The Apex Court discussed with regard to section 7 and 8 of Evidence Act and comes to a conclusion that if three conditions are complied, then court can consider the tape recorded conversation between the parties. I have already pointed out in Harpal Singh's case also, the Apex Court, considering the principles laid down in the P.V. Basir's case, not consider the CDRs, but comes to the conclusion that if other evidence is sufficient, the conviction order passed against the accused is sustainable. Merely because the digital evidence is not proved before the court, that cannot be a ground to acquit accused or consider the material and record. The court has to look into the other evidence in toto. You all know in a civil case, the preponderance of probabilities has to be considered. In a criminal case, proof beyond reasonable doubt. Preponderance of probabilities in a civil case, and in a criminal case, proof requires proof beyond reasonable doubt. Taking into note of this aspect in a case of digital evidence and also considering the other material, the judge has to apply his mind looking into the material placed before the court, whether the digital evidence compliance of section 65B is complied or not. Now it is settled law that it is mandatory to produce the certificate under section 65B for proof of secondary evidence. In case of primary evidence, there is no need to place the certificate, but in a case of secondary evidence, certificate is necessary. I hope that taking into the judgments from 1964 onwards till date, the aspect of the digital evidence elaborately discussed in all these judgments, and now in view of the larger bench decision in Arjun Kotkar's case, digital evidence, when the secondary evidence is placed before the court, certificate is must under section 65B. 65B has to be complied in toto, and it is mandatory, and the same is not procedural as held in Safi Muhammad case. The Safi Muhammad case, which was reported in 2018 in respect of coming to the conclusion that person is not in possession of the device, cannot be expected to produce the certificate, is overruled. Having considered the material available on record and also the recent judgment of Apex Court in Arjun Pandit Kotkar case, the Apex Court discussed with regard to both the provisions of Evidence Act as well as the Information Technology Act and also the definition under Section 2 under the Information Technology Act. If we go through the recent judgment of Arjun Pandit Rao Kotkar case, it will give full details with regard to the digital evidence. What would be the questions will be arises before the court considering the digital evidence. I hope that I made my efforts to share my knowledge with regard to digital evidence, the scope of digital evidence, and also scope of secondary evidence with regard to the digital evidence. If it is a primary evidence, no need to place the certificate before the court. If it is secondary evidence, then it is mandatory on the part of the person who placed the material before the court, that is digital evidence, certificate is mandatory. if any doubts with regard to the admissibility of evidence, that is digital evidence, you can pose any questions. I would like to clarify the questions. If any doubt, I can clarify the same.
Please, my lords, thank you very much for a very informative presentation. With my lord's permission, can we now move on to the Q&A session?
Yes.
Please, my lord. Mr. Vijay Kumar, I have unmuted you. You may quickly pose your question to his lordship. Mr. Vijay Kumar, I have unmuted you.
Sir, where we have to get the section 65 subclass B of the certificate, sir? Suppose if I have electronic device available with me in a criminal case, I have to get where from? I have to get the certificate, sir.
Certificate is also from the person who is acquainted with the document. What are the input are fed into the computer? If you are relying upon the document, then the from whom you are getting that document, he has to certify that document is originated from the particular device.
Mere giving a certificate is enough, sir. Formal certificate by signing, this is get from the original computer system or device.
You can examine the person before the court.
Okay, thank you.
Please, my lords. Mr. Satyanarayan Gupta has a question. Yes, sir, I have unmuted you.
I am not hearing
Hello,
you.
Sir.
Hi, yes,
Hello,
yes.
Sir. How are you? Okay. Sir,
yes.
Before leading a secondary evidence, is it not the duty of the prosecution or the plaintiff to lay the foundation for the secondary evidence, sir? When the primary evidence is not available, the question of secondary evidence comes. Is it not the duty of the plaintiff to establish the foundation to lead the secondary evidence?
He has to put the foundation.
Yes.
If he is relying upon the secondary evidence, then he has to place the material with certificate, because now it is made it as compulsory, it is mandatory. But only in the Sonu case, the apex court discussed with regard to raising of objections. The other side has to raise the objection at the time of marking the document. If the objection is raised, then the prosecution can cure the same. That is the law laid down by the apex court.
That is it. Mr. Vijay Kumar just now raised the issue. Thank you, sir. Thank you.
Yes, sir.
Thank you, sir. Mr. Ramesh Chandra has a question. Sir, I have unmuted you.
Yes, Ramesh Chandra.
If the original deliberately suppressed,
then
in order to have some gain, and they are producing the secondary evidence, whether such a exercise could be done under section 65B,
then you have to make out the case. The original primary document is available.
Yes.
Then you know all procedure. You can cause notice to other side to produce the primary document.
Now the origin is destroyed or something done by the person who is producing the second
custody.
Yes, he is the custodian of the original evidence. Yes. He suppressed and he has also destroyed it. He has makes a statement that I have destroyed it. Then secondary evidence could be like in respect of a digital.
If primary evidence is not available.
He destroys deliberately.
Then you have to make out the case that he has deliberately destroyed the document.
That he makes a statement. He makes a statement.
An appreciation of evidence.
Thank you,
ma'am. Please, my lords. Do we have any more questions? Yes, Mr. Kemparna has a question.
Yes, Kemparna, please.
I have unmuted you.
Good evening, sir.
Yes, good evening.
Sir, what are the
primary evidence and the secondary evidence in digital forms.
That is original is original is primary evidence.
Like in a that documentary is, evidence, that is the original.
In Harpal Singh's case, the apex court says when there is a conversation between the two persons, that is tape recording person. In Harpal Singh's case, Supreme Court says PDR's electronic evidence in the nature of secondary evidence cannot be admitted unless requirements of section is satisfied. In the present case, CDRs are produced to prove conspiracy. Not in Harpal's case, in another case, one second. Vikram alias Vicky Wali and another versus State of Punjab and another 2017 eight Supreme Court cases held. For example, 62 of Evidence Act, admissibility of electronic records. Original tape recorded conversation of ransom call handed over to police. Held it is a primary evidence. And therefore, certificate under section 65B is not required. Such certificate is necessary only for secondary evidence. That is, if original tape recorded version is available, then the same can be placed before the court. That is primary evidence.
How can we prove that it is a original record error?
Then again, you have to examine the material which has been placed before the court. If you are disputing the same, again the burden lies on you. Whether it is genuine or not. Why section 65B is introduced for the reason is that because all these documents are susceptible to tampering. 65B why it is mandated is for the authenticity of the document and genuineness of the digital evidence. That is the reason it is mandatory to comply section 65B.
Much obliged.
Main focus on section 65B is genuinity of the document of digital evidence.
Please, Mirods. We have one offline question, but I'm afraid if it is relevant, I would just read it out to your lordships. Chandrasekhar has this question. In a matter regarding revenue documents, which are now digital, that is RTC, the revenue officers may not be experts. Still, they are competent to give certificate under section 65B of the Evidence Act.
Now, because the law is made it clear, now it is digitized. Digital form document. Again, the veracity of his evidence, the person who comes and deposes before the court, the evidence of the person certificate who has issued, again subject to the analyzing of the evidence by the court. Whether he is having knowledge or not, again, to be tested in court.
Please.
Whether he has issued the certificate without having any knowledge, then again, it is a subject matter of appreciation by the court.
Please, my lords. Do we have any more questions before we wind up today's session? All right. Mr. Harish and Mr. Shankarbhat has a question.
Showing his hands.
Yes, sir. Mr. Shankar, but sir, I have unmuted you.
Mute your mic and come on video.
Yes, in one important matter on IPR matter, the disc was subject to analysis by cloned CD.
Yes.
Then that disc was subjected matter of a report by one of the experts.
Yes.
Private lab.
Yes.
Now the report was submitted to the court in such circumstances. The original CD was not subject matter. It was cloned CD which was subject matter of analysis. In such circumstances, how to analyze, sir? How to appreciate the evidence? How to
Again, you know the scope of Section 45.
No, 65, the certificate is required. No, in that sense.
Certificate is required under Section 65B. If the document is placed before the court, the expert is examined under Section 45, you know that the report of the expert is not mandatory, it is directory. Opinion of the expert is not mandatory, it is directory.
Thank you, sir.
If any evidence before the court with regard to the expert opinion, in respect of the digital evidence only, the section 45A and 47A are incorporated regarding yes. opinion of the experts.
Yes. Thank you.
Yes, my lord. Sir, Mr. Harish, sir, I have unmuted you. Very quickly, you may pose your question.
Sir, please come on.
Good evening, sir.
Yes, sir.
Sir, see, the Evidence Act heavily relies upon a certificate under 65B4.
Yes. Or
today in a cloud computing world, how do you appreciate collection? There is no guidelines under the Act, either under the IT Act or under the Evidence Act, for collection and appreciation of this digital evidence, which is on cloud computing. So, in the absence of a 65B certificate, can an expert opinion substitute the certificate as far as such type of digital evidence are concerned?
Now, the judgment of the
apex computing, you cannot know who is going to certify.
The certify that the person who is having acquainted with the material which he has supplied, and he has to give certificate. Now, the apex court made it clear that it is mandatory. Certificate is mandatory, Section 65B.
I example, sir, I have my data on the emails on the cloud computing in my own thing. So I will produce it, so I will have to certify it, self-certification it becomes.
But now
an expert opinion substitute my certification?
Earlier your question is, in the absence of certificate under Section 65B, whether the expert opinion can be considered.
Correct.
But in view of the law laid down by the apex court in Arjun Pandit Rao Kotkar case, it is mandatory to produce the certificate. Then again question arises before the court is with regard to the validity of that certificate. But it is compulsory, it is mandatory in view of the judgment. Because in 2020, earlier judgment of PV Basis case upheld by the larger bench again, then it is compulsory, it is mandatory, certificate is mandatory. Then again court has to examine with regard to the validity of the said certificate in consonance with the evidence of expert.
So it has to be supplemented with the expert opinion. That's
all. Yes.
Because in some case I can give a certificate myself because my data is on cloud computing.
Certificate is mandatory. Court has to examine again with regard to the authenticity of the certificate issued by the person.
Thank you, sir.
But it cannot be substituted by expert opinion.
Thank you, sir.
Yes.
Please, my lord. So one last question offline. Mr. Balasubramanya has this question. Is the certificate under Section 65B required for primary evidence?
Not under that's
in cyber crimes.
I referred to Harpal Singh case. Vikram case. Vikram Singh alias Vicky reported in 2017, Supreme Court page 518.
Please.
Certificate is necessary for only secondary evidence. Section 65B is meant for only secondary evidence. General Section 63 and 65 is not applicable.
Please.
Again, we have to go back to provisions of Section 65B. That is a special amendment made to the Evidence Act.
Please. Do we have any more questions before we wrap up today's session? I think that's about it. My lords, on behalf of Advocates Association Bengaluru, I extend a sincere thanks to your lordships for today's very educative presentation. Thank you so much.
Thank you. I also thank the patient hearing and given me an opportunity to share my little knowledge with the legal legendaries. Thank you.
With my Lord's permission, now I'll be signing off today's webinar.
Yes. Thank you. Namaste.